Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear stories from Brian Lynn and Anna Mateo. Later, Jill Robbins and John Russell present an everyday grammar lesson on separable phrasal verbs. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day. But first,
illegal gold mining operations in Ghana have reportedly increased in recent years. The activities present dangerous risks to the individuals involved, as well as environmental harms. The Reuters news agency recently reported on the issue. Reporters with the news agency visited such an operation in western Ghana. They found that workers were not using professional protective equipment as they mined for gold in muddy water filled with mercury. Groups of unofficial miners wore normal clothes and used only their hands to remove rocks. The unlicensed mine is in the country's Prestia-Huni Valley District. It is an example of how increasing numbers of people are turning to illegal methods to find gold to earn money. Mining officials in Ghana say such operations can harm miners' health, pollute waterways, destroy forests and farms, and increase crime rates. One of the men working at the illegal mine told Reuters, "It's risky, but I just want to survive." The man was a 24-year-old accounting student. He did not want to be named because he is involved in illegal activities. He told Reuters he had been missing classes to search for gold because he needs the money. The unlicensed gold mining industry is known in Ghana as galamse. The industry has grown quickly over the past year. One reason for the growth was a 30% rise in international gold prices. Small mines produced 34 million grams of gold in the first 7 months of this year, official government records show. That was more than in all of 2023. About 40% of Ghana's total gold comes from small mines, those not owned by large international companies. And an estimated 70-80% of the small mines are unlicensed. News reports and human rights groups say numerous miners have died from collapsing pits in recent years. Hospitals and health centers have reported high numbers of early deaths from heart-related diseases of miners and people living in towns and villages near mines. The health problems are linked to breathing in dust that contains heavy metals such as lead. In addition, poisonous gas from the mercury and nitric acid are released during unlicensed mine activities. Such chemicals are also dumped on the ground or in rivers. Ghana's Water Authority says mercury and heavy metals from mining have poisoned about 65% of water sources. The illegal operations have also harmed thousands of hectares of cocoa farms and forest areas, reports data gathering group Global Forest Watch. Protesters have taken to the streets in Ghana's capital, Accra, in recent weeks. They have criticized President Nana Akufo-Addo's government over a lack of attention to the problems. Some demonstrators carried signs that said, "Leaders, you've failed us." Abubakar Sadek took part in a protest on the issue September 22nd. He told Reuters, "Galamse has to stop. We want to live long. We don't want to fall sick. We don't want to go to the hospital." I'm Brian Lynn.
The Grand Egyptian Museum in Giza will open a limited number of exhibits about ancient Egypt starting this week. The limited opening will be a test run of the still unannounced official opening of the museum, officials said. Starting on October 16th, 4,000 visitors per day will be permitted to view limited areas of the main galleries, said Al-Tayeb Abbas. He is assistant to Egypt's Minister of Antiquities. Museum officials have repeatedly delayed the museum opening for many reasons, including the COVID-19 pandemic. Some areas have been open since 2022. For limited tours. The museum is a huge project near the famous Giza pyramids. The building project began more than 12 years ago and has cost more than $1 billion so far. The Egyptian government says more than 100,000 artifacts of Egypt's ancient treasures are on show at the site. Officials describe it as the world's largest archaeological museum. The exhibits in the test run include 12 areas that explore issues related to society, religion, and philosophies of ancient Egypt, Abbas added. The areas are divided by dynasty and historical order. Historical divisions include the Third Intermediate Period, Late Period, and Greco-Roman Period. It also includes the New Kingdom, Middle Kingdom, and Old Kingdom periods. They all represent life thousands of years in the past. One of the areas displays statues of the elite of the king. These represent members of a king's family and high-level officials who worked in the army, government, or religious service. Abbas told the AP that the test run would help prepare for the full opening by identifying operational issues. This includes finding out which parts of the museum might become overcrowded. A reporter for the Associated Press spoke with some tourists at the museum. Canadian visitor Aude Porceda told the AP she was amazed by the museum. She said she believes it is important that the world know about Egyptian civilization. Jorge Licano, a visitor from Costa Rica, expressed similar praise. "There is a lot of history and a lot of things we are not aware of, especially coming from the other side of the world. and seeing everything here and learning from the locals has been great, he said. The limited opening includes the museum's so-called grand staircase. It is 6 stories high, with a view of the nearby pyramids. Also open to the public are artifacts that include sarcophagi and statues. Other parts of the museum, including the King Tutankhamun treasure collection, are set to open at later dates. All the exhibit space is equipped with high-level technology and permit different kinds of media presentations to help explain the lives of ancient Egyptians, including kings, said museum official Aisa Zidane. Some exhibits will use virtual reality to explain the history of burial and its development throughout ancient Egypt. The museum is not only a place to display antiquities, but it also aims to attract children to learn about ancient Egyptian history. The museum is a gift to all the world, Zidane told the AP. I'm Ana Mateo.
Welcome back to Everyday Grammar from VOA Learning English. Today, we return to a very common verb form in English, phrasal verbs. You will find one phrasal verb in every 192 words of written English. They will make your English sound more natural once you begin using them correctly. In an earlier program, we explained how and why English speakers use them. Today, we look at some often used phrasal verbs. This type of phrasal verb allows a direct object to come between the verb and the preposition or adverb. As you will hear, there is a special rule that learners should know about when using these 10 phrasal verbs.
As you know, a phrasal verb is a phrase with 2 or more words, a verb and a preposition, or adverb, or both. We call the preposition or adverb a particle when it combines with a verb. Here are 2 examples.
Please put the lamp on the desk. I think you're putting me on.
In the first sentence, on is a preposition showing the position of the lamp. In the second sentence, on is an adverbial particle. Put on is a phrasal verb meaning fool or trick in this sentence.
An important point is that a regular verb plus preposition combination has 2 meanings. A phrasal verb, that is, a verb plus particle, has a single meaning within a sentence. Many phrasal verbs have a number of different meanings in different situations. Yet, the meaning of the verb plus particle can usually be expressed with a single Latin-based verb. Here are 2 sentences with the same meaning.
They tore down the old building. They demolished the old building.
The verb tear has its own meaning, and so does the preposition down. They can combine with other words when they are alone. But as a phrasal verb, tear down, they have 1 meaning, destroy. In 1987, U.S. President Ronald Reagan visited West Germany. He told a crowd in the divided city of Berlin,
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Now for the tricky part. You know that some verbs are transitive, which means they have a direct object. When such verbs appear as phrasal verbs, an object can either separate the phrase or follow it. Here's an example.
I decided to throw out my old jeans. I decided to throw my old jeans out.
Both of these sentences are correct. The object of the phrasal verb throw out is jeans. You can use a pronoun instead of jeans and ask,
Are you sure you want to throw them out?
However, you cannot ask,
Are you sure you want to throw out them?
Here, the pronoun them must appear between the verb and the particle.
In recent years, language experts began to use computers to examine a large collection, or corpus, of written and spoken language. When researchers look for phrasal verbs, they find that many deal with an activity. They also find a few verbs combine with many particles. Among the most common verbs are come, put, get, go, pick, sit, and take. These combine with the adverb particles up, out, in, on, off, and down to make up a group of very useful phrasal verbs. Now, let's look at transitive phrasal verbs. See the list at the end of the article. The verb get is part of many phrasal verbs. For example, we use get up to mean to wake oneself up or to awaken someone. For example,
My son loves to sleep late. I got him up on time to catch the bus this morning.
Remember, the pronoun has to come between the verb and the adverb. So we cannot say,
I got up him.
Notice how the Norwegian group AHA uses a separable phrasal verb two ways in their song, Take on Me. Which one is correct in formal grammar?
I'll be coming for your love, okay? Take on me, take on me. Take me on, take on me. I'll be gone in a day or two.
For Learning English Everyday Grammar, I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm John Russell.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In another lesson of the day, we started to look at Lesson 37 of the series. In Lesson 37, Anna starts talking to a man who is visiting Washington, D.C. The man lives in a rural area and does not feel comfortable in the city. Soon, Anna and the man start talking about whether they prefer to live in the city or the country.
And in this situation, the word country just means a rural area. Let's listen to their conversation.
Thank you. Thank you.
Are you okay? You seem nervous.
Well, this is my first visit to Washington, D.C. I'm from a small town in the country. I feel a little lost.
I'm from the country, too. And I understand. When I first came here, I felt lost all the time.
So, do you like living in the country or in the city?
I like to live in the city.
Why?
The city is exciting. It has more culture than the country. There are many museums and restaurants. Every night, there's theater and music. And there are more jobs. That is why I'm here.
Well, I agree. There is more culture in the city, and there might be more jobs, but the country has more nature. It's peaceful and beautiful. There are more trees and mountains. The air is clean. You can go hiking and camping. The city is not beautiful. It's noisy and dirty.
I disagree. I think all the different buildings are beautiful. And I like to watch all the different people.
That's another thing that is different. People in the country are friendly. They always say hello. Here, no one says hello. I think city people are rude.
Well, I agree. Country people are friendly. But I don't think city people are rude. I think they're just busy.
That's a good point.
Anna and the man disagree because they have different preferences, which means things they prefer or like more.
And I think it's important to notice that even though they disagree about some things, they are not really arguing or fighting about their preferences.
True. They are not being disagreeable.
Disagreeable is an adjective we can use to describe people behaving in a negative or rude way.
Unpleasant is another adjective we can use to describe this.
Like, we can say that a way in which a person is talking is disagreeable or unpleasant.
And with Anna and the man, we can say that they are acting agreeably.
We know that might sound strange to our listeners. Anna and the man disagree, but they are acting agreeably. That means they are speaking nicely to each other.
That's right. Just like the adjective disagreeable, the adjective agreeable can describe a person.
If someone is agreeable, they are pleasant and try to please other people.
So, listeners, see if you understand this sentence. They are agreeably disagreeing.
That means they are disagreeing in a nice way.
Remember, it's fine to disagree. There's no problem with that. But try not to be disagreeable when you disagree.
I'm Jill Robbins, and you're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. In their conversation, Anna and the man do agree about some things.
That's right. They do find some common ground. They agree that there are more jobs in the city and that people from the country are friendly.
To find common ground means to find things that you agree about, even when you disagree about other things. Now let's listen to the rest of Lesson 37 and find out what else they might agree on.
Well, I agree. Country people are friendly. But I don't think city people are rude. I think they're just busy.
That's a good point.
Look at me. I live in the city, and I said hello to you.
But you are from the country.
I have an idea. let's say hello to people. To many people.
What? Why?
Well, if we say hello, then they will say hello to other people. Hello?
And they will say hello to more people. That's a great idea. I'm glad you found my bag.
Come on, let's go say hello to people. We don't have to agree with people. They have their opinions, we have ours. And as we like to say, you can always agree to disagree. Until next time, hello!
In the city, saying hello to all the people who walk past you on the street is not normal behavior.
But then again, Anna does not always behave normally.
No, she doesn't. When Anna and the man go up to lots of people in the city and say hello, they are breaking a cultural norm.
As you can hear, the word norm sounds similar to the word normal. A cultural norm is a behavior, attitude, or belief that is commonly shared within a certain culture.
For example, in the United States, it is a cultural norm to apologize if you are late for a meeting. Another cultural norm is for men and women to shake hands when they meet at a business meeting.
We can say that people break cultural norms when they show behaviors, attitudes, or beliefs not commonly shared within a culture.
And we use the verb adhere, spelled A-D-H-E-R-E, plus the preposition to talk about following the usual or normal behaviors within a culture.
For example, we might say in an important business or government meeting, people usually adhere to cultural norms.
In a physical sense, the verb adhere means to stick to something. For example, glue adheres to most surfaces.
Social norms means the same thing as cultural norms.
That's a good point. Now, let's review some of the vocabulary from today's lesson of the day.
We have the adjectives agreeable and disagreeable to describe either good or bad behaviors or conditions.
And we have the adverb form of those words, agreeably and disagreeably.
And we have the words pleasant and unpleasant, which also describe good and bad.
Then there's the expression, find common ground.
And next we talk about cultural or social norms and the expressions break cultural norms and adhere to cultural norms.
Now, here's something for our listeners to do. Write to us and tell us what you think is an important cultural norm in your own culture. We might discuss what you tell us in a future lesson of the day.
And you can email that to learningenglish@voanews.com. Remember, you can find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. You can also find all the episodes of Let's Learn English on our website at learningenglish.voanews.com. And thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.